Hankies. I am Damika, and this is my sister,
Tredana.
And we are so excited. We know that we ended last month as we culminated with a great show last Sunday. We had Michi on, and this month we are doing Men's Empowerment Month. Last month we did Women's Empowerment, so we want to empower men. We have a special guest coming. He's running a little bit behind schedule. Has such a busy schedule, but as you guys are coming in, please share the video. We also know this is Father's Day. This is not Father's Day itself, but this is the month that we celebrate Father's Day. So we're using the whole month of June to celebrate and commemorate men. And so we're going to be having some special shows. Some special guests are going to be coming on, and we pray that you guys are blessed. We want to make sure that we share with you the call-in number, which is 312-629-4499. 312-629-4499. So if you do have anything that you want to share with the men of God and just men in general, we ask that you would call in. You can share stories. You can share nuggets of wisdom. Just anything that would encourage the men on today.
The topic is God's man, God's messenger, God's masterpiece. So just thinking about that, as you guys want to call in again, God's man, God's messenger, God's masterpiece. Just what is that? What does that mean to you? What is it from a woman's perspective, and then from a male perspective too? So as our special guest is making his way in, he is in ministry. He's doing so many different things we're going to talk about. So that's why he is running a little bit late. So as you can call in, and just any questions that you may have on, that are questions, comments about being God's man, God's, messenger, God's masterpiece. What does that mean from that, male perspective or from the female perspective as well? What does that look like?
And I know we do have some females on, and we bless God for men. We bless God for men. It's a blessing to know good, strong men of God.
Praise God.
It's a blessing to know men. And my sister, I know you guys always see us together. You see pictures of us together, but we do have four brothers,
yes,
as well. And we are blessed where we grew up in a two-parent household. My father's going to be on later this month too. But
yeah, he's coming on for Father's Day, my dad and uncle. So we're excited about that.
And so we like the energy, the wisdom that men bring to our lives, the lives of our sons, the inspiration that they bring to our lives. And so it's such a blessing to know good men. And so even in raising sons, raising a son, and my sister has a son, but both of us in raising sons, we learned that we needed strong men to help us in raising it and rearing our
yes,
own sons.
Yes.
And we pray that they would grow up and be mighty men of God.
So we see you coming in. Hello, Annette. How are you? Hope everyone enjoyed church.
Church was good.
Thank you, Annette. Yes, they did say they cannot hear me. Thank you. So we're again just talking about God's, I was just going over the topic again, God's man, God's messenger, God's masterpiece. So that's what we're talking about today. And our guest, Al Conley, will be in shortly. And we're just going to talk to him about what this is. So you guys can also share out as well. What does that mean to you? God's man, God's messenger, God's masterpiece. What is that to you? How are we looking at the men today? How are we looking at men of God? How are we looking at what God has created from the female perspective as well as from the male perspective? So we do like to do that. That was not Calvin Bridges singing. That was
Jason Nelson. And I guess while we're waiting on Al to come in, I can talk about the first man that I ever met, my dad. And I'm sure my sister would agree with me. I always say that my dad is probably the hardest working man that I've ever met. My dad is one. My grandmother bore 19 children. And I've known my dad all my life, of course. You know, but he set an example for my brothers to follow. He's been a great example for my own son, for my nephew. My oldest nephew's away at college, and then I have other nephews that have other younger nephews as well, and nieces. My dad has been a mighty example as a father, as a husband, as an employee, he was once a deacon, then the Lord called him to be in ministry. So I've been blessed to see the first example that I've seen of a mighty man was my own dad. And so, and even in how he raised us to be young ladies, but especially in how he raised my own brothers to grow up and be good men.
Amen.
That my son can look up to and that my nephew can look up
right.
to. So we encourage you all to call in, even the ladies that are on here, call in, talk about some of the men in your lives. It can be your dad, it can be your brother, and how they have inspired you, how you've seen the man of God that they've been, how you've watched them spread the message of God, and how they are a masterpiece, because we know that God created us as his masterpiece. He formed us to be an example. And so as we commemorate and celebrate men on today, we want you to call in. Our opening scripture for today is Ephesians 6:10. It says, finding my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. God, and then we said, our topic is God's man, God's messenger, and God's masterpiece. Do you want to say anything about that?
He's the greatest ever, right? So we're so excited about Men's Month and have our dad coming on too, definitely for Father's Day. So we're excited about that. You guys gonna make sure you watch in too next Sunday. It's gonna be awesome. Just like this show will be definitely awesome to have our dad on next Sunday. So we'll start with talking about Al Conley as he's coming in now. So we are so glad he's here. Hello, yay!
Thank
the Lord. So we have our guest in today. Al Conley.
And so we know you're rushing in, yes, and trying to breathe. And yes, so we'll give you a minute. We're just talking about, so we know you're running in and ripping and running the church. Yes. And we're going to talk about all that. You know, you had some things that delayed you. So we do understand. But yes, we were talking about just how men can impact your lives. And I talked about the first man that I ever met that I spent the most time with is my dad, you know. Yes. And so and we're glad to have you on here, yes, as we empower men on this month. You're kicking it off. Yes. Last month, we empowered women. And so we're glad to have you on here, because you are literally all over the place. And so I don't know if they knew who you were, but after this show, they're going to know. And then when you say who you are, they're going to be like, oh, I may have seen him before. So we're going to let you tell. I wanted her to tell how we met you.
Yeah,
and then I can kind of go.
Sure. So I was looking for someone to make my son a suit, and he's getting ready to go to prom, and I mean, he came like with these high accolades, like, mm-hmm, and they were not sure if I was going to be able to get this man Al Conley, because somebody, like, they was like, well, I wanted him to make a dress, but he was kind of booked, but maybe he could make the suit for your son. I was like, oh, and when she started showing me some of the things that you had done, uh-huh, some other photos, I was like, no, he has to make Caleb's suit. So all of you that saw Caleb's prom suit, that was so well designed. It was the one with the gold lace trim that you may see some suiting, you know. Because when Caleb told, you all know my son Caleb, he's a little, he's an artist, so he dresses a little eccentric. So when he told me he wanted to wear lace, I was like, you want to wear lace, Caleb? So just how he executed that suit to be still so manly, you know what I'm saying?
Yes, I understand.
You know what I'm saying? So it was just really so nice. But this is how we met Al Conley, and he's just been like just great person to know, and just to watch as God is doing so many different things in your life. So that's what we're excited about. We knew that you were the first great person to open up this, and we're so glad you accept our invitation.
Yeah, and he wasn't hesitant at all. Then I got to say, so I met him through my sister. He came at my parents' house to measure Caleb. I don't know if it was for the first measurement or if he was following up. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, what's to him? He about to make a suit, you know? Because I hadn't saw any pictures. But good Lord, he is a talented tailor.
Yes.
And he says he's a tailor, right?
Yes, right.
Talk about the difference between a tailor and just somebody who just
custom. The difference between custom.
Yeah,
fitting.
I'm gonna let you say that custom, later, yes, on, because we want to make sure that the brothers know that.
That's right.
You know,
they need to know.
Custom fitting comes with a price tag too. That's right.
It does. It does. Come, yes.
Somebody comes to your where you live at, and they measure you. But
yes,
we're gonna
it
talk
was
about
really
that.
It and it set like a standard for my son. So I appreciate that for him to have that experience, that somebody come out and fit you, and you know what I'm saying, set a standard for.
He's
him.
He's a classy young man. And he has expensive taste.
So I have to see if I can get in that class next year. I may have to get another job. But I met him through my sister, and he, like we have already said, he did an outstanding job on tailoring, customizing Caleb's prom suit. And then I reached out to him when I had my career day, and he came without hesitance. He was great, just down to earth brother. And this he has so many things that he can mention that he does and he's done. So it's an honor to have him kick this off, and I'm sure that you're going to share some things with men that can empower them and encourage them on today.
Sure,
so
sure.
To have you. So you can tell us a little bit more about yourself.
Well, first, I am absolutely honored and humbled to be here
Thank you.
Beautiful ladies on today. You all could have picked anybody, and I'm still trying to figure out why you picked me. I'm just a nappy-headed boy from the south side of Chicago. I am Georgian Lucas' son.
And
my mother, she was an educator for over 30 years in Chicago public schools.
Wow.
And for me, I'm not a PK, but I feel like a PK because though my mother was not a preacher, she was a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
My grandfather was the dominant male influence in my life. He wasn't a preacher, but he was a deacon. And he was ordained a deacon ever since the age of 16.
Oh, wow. Mm.
And I watched him study Sunday school lessons mm-hmm. Saturday night. And it was me, I didn't know it, but this was the same work ethic that a preacher mm-hmm. should be taken as they're preparing. I said should, because not all, you know. But he was preparing for a Sunday school lesson. And I remember watching that as early as age 3. And I tell people now that I remember being called as early as 3.
Wow. Called to?
To the ministry.
Amen.
Now, called to the ministry, called to preach. Now, I didn't want to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I ran and ran and ran. And mainly because, to me, preaching, it was too close to teaching.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I didn't want to do anything that was remotely close to what my mother
Amen.
Was doing.
Mm-hmm.
Mainly because I didn't grow up with the father in the home.
Mm-hmm.
Though I had my grandfather as the dominant male mm-hmm. influence, it was still something that my mother was, she was my main go-to person.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I didn't want to do what my mother did. So as time went on, I remember being in church,
mm-hmm.
16 years old, Trinity All Nations Church, 97th and Vincennes. My pastor was Dr. Evelyn Davis.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
I don't know if you all remember her. Powerful woman of God.
Mm-hmm.
And we were in convocation this particular week. And I'm, you know, nappy-headed boy from the south side of Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
As my mother would say, mannish.
Mm-hmm.
I was a bad little kid. But the adults didn't know it, mainly because I knew how to act mm-hmm. in public.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I didn't want to get a whooping mm-hmm. by Georgiana. So in church, I was well behaved. But this one particular night during convocation, I'll never forget it, sitting on the front row of the church, the man of God, Bishop Craig Bayman from Memphis, Tennessee,
mm-hmm.
he points me out. Out of all of the people in the church, he points me out and he says, young man, you have an apostolic anointing on your life. Now, all of the other kids, they knew Al Conley. Mm-hmm. They knew the real Al. They're like, what in the world is this man talking about? I knew exactly what he was talking
mm-hmm.
about, but
wow.
I did not want to hear it
mm-hmm.
because I knew it had something to do with preaching.
Wow.
He said, apostolic anointing. I'm like, no, I don't. That's what I'm saying to myself. And then later on, fast forward, at around the age of 21,
mm-hmm.
I began to dive deeper into the Word of mm-hmm. God, and I began to understand that God wanted me to do something different
mm-hmm.
than what I pretty much had made up in my mind that I was going to do. I sang in a singing group. It was a quartet group.
He's doing everything.
I did everything. I was everything but preaching. I was running. And I couldn't get away from it. My singing group, we went to the House of Blues. We sang for an orphanage
mm-hmm.
on Thanksgiving Day. God had given us so much favor. In this orphanage, there's the ghetto boys were there. Now, see, I know y'all saved now, but, you know.
We know.
Yes.
No, we know.
Who the ghetto boys are. The ghetto boys were there and all these other artists. It was a group called Entourage.
Mm-hmm.
But we had a little gospel group. And after everyone got done doing what they were doing, we sang our gospel songs. Some of it was original.
Mm-hmm.
So we didn't know how they were going to receive us.
Mm-hmm.
We sang that original music, and do you know, when we were finished, all of these young people were coming up to us asking us for autographs.
Wow.
They didn't even know who we were, wow. but the music Praise that we God. Sang touched their heart.
Right, mm-hmm. right.
I'm setting this up for
mm-hmm.
a reason.
Mm-hmm.
So we're signing autographs, and this lady who was running the orphanage, she comes up to me, and I'll never forget it. She has an afro. And she says, young man, when you all were up there singing, you were more in the background. She said, but I saw you in the forefront.
Wow.
And she said, you were in the forefront. She said, but you weren't singing. She said, I see you. You were overseas. You were doing other things.
Mm.
But you weren't singing.
Mm.
I knew exactly what that woman was talking about. So when she finished, I said, God bless you. God bless you. I said, fellas, we got to hurry up and get out of here. Let's pack up. Let's go. We did what we were supposed to do.
Amen.
So that was at that age of my life. And then at 25, I began having dreams. I was preaching in my sleep.
Mm-hmm.
And
wow,
God wouldn't let me sleep for like 3 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, I met another woman of God, Elois Jones, and she took me under her wings. And she allowed me to perfect my craft. I'm still perfecting it, still growing in it. But I love people. She taught me servitude.
Mm-hmm.
So at the
mm-hmm.
end of the day, in this journey, the most valuable piece that I've learned is how to serve people.
Amen.
And so to this day, I don't consider myself a preacher. I consider myself to be a communicator of the gospel
mm-hmm.
because it encompasses a whole lot more than just preaching.
Amen.
So that brings me to the other facet of my life with the tailoring, which you all have alluded to.
Mm-hmm.
It's a service.
Amen.
I provide the service to the people. So that's Amen. Why I don't have a storefront now, because that personal touch where I'm able to drive to
right.
someone's home,
right.
bring the fabrics in,
mm-hmm.
educate them on mm-hmm. the whole process.
Right.
Service, and if you know anything about businesses,
mm-hmm.
the businesses that are thriving today, even in the midst of a failing
mm-hmm.
economy,
mm-hmm.
the businesses that offer service
right.
are the
That's
ones
so
that are still thriving.
That's
right.
so true.
The reason why the church should be thriving right now is because we should specialize in service.
That's right.
That the reason
so
why
true.
We need men in our churches.
You hitting the question.
Right, already, right?
The reason why we need men in our churches is because men can serve and do things that women can do, but should not have to
mm-hmm.
do.
Amen.
And I know we're leading with Father's Day is coming up.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to subscribe to that when they would say, let's give it up for all the mothers to step in, dads, the mothers that have to be fathers.
Nope.
I used to, though.
Mm-hmm.
Mainly because my mother,
right.
I watched my mother do the things that I wanted my father to do.
Mm-hmm.
And my mother, though, when I got older, I realized that my mother did not baby me.
Mm-hmm.
My mother, though I'm the only child,
mm-hmm.
my mother didn't. She wasn't one of those who just cuddled me, kept me under her arms.
Amen.
My mother allowed me to get beat up. I remember getting in a fight. Now, I didn't get beat up
mm-hmm.
by the gentleman I was fighting. So I got into this fight.
And
my glasses were broken.
And you didn't get beat up?
I didn't get beat up, but my glasses ended up getting broken. And I got home, and my mother said, she said, what happened to your glasses? I said, well, I got into a fight. She said, boy, the next time you get in a fight, you take those glasses off. I paid too much money for them glasses. She ain't asked me who won
right.
or whatever.
She said, take the glasses off.
She said, take those glasses off. But those were the type of experiences that I still appreciate.
Amen.
My mother passed away 2011. But I still remember
wow.
everything that she instilled in me. I remember when I was 6 years old, 5 years old, and my mother was reading books with me.
Wow.
And she
mm-hmm.
would record it with the dictaphone
mm-hmm.
So that I could go back and hear myself.
Wow.
And but my mother, she was always educating. Men today,
wise woman,
they have to be educated. We speak mm-hmm. so much in America. We deal so much with training. We want to train our young men to do
mm-hmm.
this.
Mm-hmm.
And I know the scripture, we've quoted it, train up a child in the way mm-hmm. that they should go.
Mm-hmm.
But the Hebrew writer really wasn't talking about training in the sense that we believe
right.
training to be.
Mm-hmm.
Teaching, giving someone a skill, and we taking them through the ABCs, showing them how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
They're really talking about educating, because the Hebrews, the ancient Hebrews, they educated one another by sharing stories.
Mm-hmm.
So they would share those stories, and it was
mm-hmm.
an educational moment.
Mm-hmm.
we don't have that in the village mm-hmm. today where we're yeah. sharing stories, Amen. Where we're educating young men Amen. On how to be young men.
Amen.
They're being trained. Mm-hmm. They're being trained by mm-hmm. the village. And that saying, oh, it takes a village, we have to alter that saying mm-hmm. and start saying it takes a healthy village.
Amen.
Yeah.
We have right. to start right. rethinking that that phrase, start looking at the village. How unhealthy is the village?
Mm-hmm.
Because there's an unhealthy village raising our men. The streets are raising our men. And then in the church, everything now has this feminine connotation to it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know,
everything's been feminized. It has been.
It's been feminized. Mm-hmm. And so how do you deal with that?
Right.
For me, the main approach that I take is a man, what makes you a man? It's not the fact that you have children. It's mm-hmm. not that you are able to get a car, you have a home. All the things that America says
mm-hmm.
you're successful.
Stuff.
The things, mm-hmm. material things.
Mm-hmm.
That does not make you a man. I heard someone, one of my mentors said, he said, what makes you a man is when you realize that your life, everything about your life, is more important to someone else.
Mm-hmm.
So when you start giving of yourself, so that service, that level of service, mm-hmm. where you're not self-serving.
Mm-hmm.
In our country, we've taught leadership. You gotta lead, gotta lead, gotta lead. I grew up for many of my years in the ministry after I accepted my call to the ministry, and I'm kind of fast-forwarding the story.
Mm-hmm.
After I left Elois Jones, I went and sat under Bishop Arthur Embrasure.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
One of the greatest men I have ever met.
Mm-hmm.
There will never be another Bishop Arthur Embrasure. But this is one thing that I've noticed about the church. We spent years teaching leadership. You gotta lead. Our men need to step up and mm-hmm. be leaders.
Mm-hmm.
But this is what happens. If you teach leadership while neglecting to teach servitude, what you end up doing is breeding self-serving leaders.
Wow.
Mm.
And that's what has happened.
That's really good. Self-serving leaders.
Self-serving leaders.
Okay, before you continue, we want to ask you some questions. You have
sure.
so much wisdom.
If you guys could just share the video as you're coming in, thank you all for your comments and your feedback, but please make sure you're sharing too.
And you've, like
said so much.
I'm sorry. I'm a preacher, so y'all got me up here talking.
I was representing in front of the mic. So those of you that are just coming in, thank you so much. We have Al Conley. He is a minister. I know you're cool with us calling you
absolutely.
Al. So
absolutely.
That's I didn't want to give it away on the flyer, but
I'm going to get up and walk away from it. They called me by my first name.
We're so pleased to have him here. So those of you that are coming in, we want to ask you some of the questions that we had. Simple questions, too. The first one, how long have you been a professional tailor, by the way?
So I've been a tailor now for over 20 years.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Okay.
I trained under a gentleman named Hodge. Hodge was a fourth-generation tailor from Ghana, and
mm-hmm.
He showed me the ropes. He studied in Paris, studied in London,
mm-hmm.
and most of the tailors who I was looking up to here in America, they studied under grandma. So
that's true. That's true. When I asked, that's what they say.
Yeah.
And I know you knew Abraham.
Yes.
One of the tailors.
Absolutely.
I can't find him, but that's just, if you can find Abraham, let me know. I can't find him. He's like, he's not where I used to find him. How do you balance being in ministry with being real, relevant, and relatable?
Well,
you kind of talked about that a little bit.
Well, one of the things, I love people. And I tell people that if you want to hear God's voice,
mm-hmm.
listen to young people.
Mm.
If you can listen to young people, not just hear them, but mm-hmm. listen to them, you will hear God speak. One of the things that's we're really dealing with now is that if you look at, I'm a Gen Xer.
Mm-hmm.
So in the 80s, rap music started to evolve, and mm-hmm. there was this language that most adults didn't want to hear. And I remember riding in the car with my mother, and I would have a cassette tape. On one side, you had the clean version of music. Then the other side, you had the explicit version. And you put it in, and you hoped the wrong side didn't play. But what was happening is that you had a generation of young people that were coming up that felt that they weren't being, no one was listening to
mm-hmm.
them. So they said, okay, you're not going to listen to me. I'm going to come up with some music that you're going to have no choice but to hear what we got
mm-hmm.
to say. And then it progressed from the music to the dance, mm-hmm. and the type of dances that were done, so mm-hmm. central, that now all of a sudden they're expressing themselves through the language, they're expressing themselves through dance, mm-hmm. all of this. So there's this hip-hop culture that's evolving.
Mm-hmm.
This is what a child psychologist, Jill Rigby, says in her book, Raising Respectful Children in a Disrespectful World. She said, we spent a generation teaching young people to love themselves.
Mm-hmm.
If no one else loves you, you love yourself.
Mm-hmm.
She says, but if you teach someone self-esteem while mm-hmm. mm-hmm. neglecting to teach self-respect, mm-hmm. what ends up happening now is there's this selfishness. And so she said, we created this do me mm-hmm. generation.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. That started with the Gen Xers. I'm going to do me. You do you. I'm going to do me.
Mm-hmm.
And so then all of a sudden now mm-hmm. you fast forward to with millennials. Millennials come on the scene and you're talking about the music that you had in the 80s.
Right.
Now you got a music now that you can listen to it over and over again on repeat and you still don't know what they said.
That's true.
But they're expressing themselves. Yeah, they're bad and bougie generation. Mm-hmm. This is what's going on. And so mm-hmm. when you listen to them though, you hear God saying, see, I've been trying to get you all to listen.
Mm-hmm.
And so, though God is not behind the music,
right.
He's allowing them to express themselves. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And they're really crying out to just be heard.
Right. That's right.
So, that's what, to answer, I know that's a long way to answer the question, but to stay relevant, I listen to young people. Amen. I listen to what they listen to. And I don't demonize it.
Mm-hmm.
But I try to teach them to discern the content.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you can discern the content, it's gonna help you understand that it's gonna help you not be judgmental mm-hmm. in life.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You can tell a mature Christian because they're less judgmental mm-hmm. than they were when they first received mm-hmm. Christ. Because mm-hmm. when we first received Jesus, we like, oh, y'all going ahead. I got the Lord. You ain't got the Holy Ghost like I got it. But then when you mature and you start making some mistakes,
right.
you still say,
mm-hmm.
so why the person that made the mistake, they're going to hell, but not you.
That's right.
But not you. That's right.
So
right.
the maturity level, then you begin it begins to manifest in the sense that you're less judgmental. So
that's real good. So so we talked about you being a tailor. You may have also seen him on Black Ink, Chicago.
Yes. I was like, that's Caleb's tailor.
So just tell us a little bit about that, too. So
you guys,
he's in ministry, doing tailor, and then we saw him on TV.
Yes. So I have to shout out Erica Malden. She's a media maven. Erica Malden, if no one else has had to take on this brutal task of listening to the sermons preached by Alan B. Conley, Erica Malden had to sit and listen to him. But she says that she tells me that she was always blessed by my messages.
Amen.
And though no one knew who I was, she works in the media industry mm-hmm. and some the executive producers of the Black Ink Crew Chicago, they asked her if she knew of any pastors would provide some counseling to a couple on the show.
Wow.
And so they mentioned some big name pastors and she said, you know what? I have someone who I think would be great.
Wow, isn't that awesome?
And they didn't know me, so they set up a conference call. And on the call, they asked me, well, what would I share with this couple? Mm-hmm. It was a couple that was dealing with some issues. And they said, what would you say to them? I said, I would simply tell them, as a minister of the gospel, my role is not to point you to religion,
mm-hmm.
nor to church.
You're listening to TabernacleRadio.org, where the masses dwell.
So, and when I said that, the producer on the phone, he said, wow, he said, I have chills right now.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, we want to go with you.
Wow.
And so I ended up providing counsel to the couple. It was only for a moment. I extended my services to them. I said, I would love to be a part of the journey.
Mm-hmm.
But they only used me for that particular scene. And but the brother did call me. He reached, Amen. Well, he texted me and asked me, would I still provide those services? because they're really the couple is going through now. But that's how I ended up on Black and Crew. So it's reality TV. I learned more about reality TV. It is real. It's scripted to a degree, but it is real life circumstances. But, you know, TV, they're still trying to pull and get some things out for television purposes.
Yeah, and that goes so well with our topic, God's man, God's messenger, you know, because opportunities that we would never even dream of will be open. You know how doors are open. The Bible talks about God taking us before mighty men. You know, just you never know how doors will open. And I believe that's because of the level of humility that you walk in.
Amen.
You know how God just opens doors. Because you said, you were like, they mentioned so many big names, and, you know, but God will open doors for us where we can be used because we have a desire to serve.
Yes.
You know, so that's a good lesson for us, you know, about the how important it is to have a level of servitude.
Amen.
You know, everybody, you know, even, you know, everybody wants to be title this, title
that's
that,
right. That's
but
right.
You have to want to serve.
Amen.
And it blesses people, you know.
That's right.
You talked about a lack of men in the church. My question was, how can we address the lack of men in the church?
Mm-hmm.
So you touched a little bit on that, but it's such a the deficit. It's such a great deficit of the amount of men that we have in the church. You know, just expound on that a little bit more.
So yes, in the universal church, there is a deficit, mainly because there would not be a church without women.
Mm-hmm.
There's no church. On Sundays, I do not want women upset in my church. My pastor, Reverend Dr. Leon Finney Jr., he tells me all the time, Alan, son, you know, that bathroom in there, did you see it? I didn't see it, Doc. Alan, if you want to run people out of your church, the quickest way to do it is upset the women. That bathroom needs to be clean. And I agree with him. You do not want to upset women. But interesting enough, at the Apostolic Church of God, where I served for 15 years, we had 50% men. Unheard of.
How did you guys do that?
50% men. Bishop Brazier was a man's man.
He was a man's
men man. Men are a lot more logical, I know, and not being male chauvinistic right now. But men are, they tend to be more logical and they think. You can't get men with the emotional touch your neighbor five times. Men are like, why are you touching me? You know, hold up. You know, that brother may have just gotten out, just released. And you talk about touch your neighbor. But nonetheless, the men, Bishop was able to relate to the men in a way where he was able to reach their mind.
Wow.
A woman, you want to reach the woman's heart.
Mm-hmm.
For a man, you have to reach his mind.
Mm-hmm.
If you can reach his mind and begin to have him think about something in a way that he did not always think about.
Mm-hmm.
That's revelation. Revelation is just a new way of looking at old things.
Mm-hmm.
When you can get a man to see something in a new way, now you're being revelatory, you're being revolutionary in that brother's life.
That is, wait a minute, I got to stop you right there, because when I posted the information about this, I said there would be some wisdom that would help the ladies out too.
Yes.
So we have to get men to think too.
Get them to think.
Yeah, say that again. Say it. Look.
Ladies,
that is good.
Get that brother to think. And hear me out now. You will not be let down if you can get that brother to think. First of all, if you can get the man to think about why is it affecting you in a way that it's affecting you, whatever it is, the fact that you don't like him driving over the speed limit. you want him to open up the car door. Men sometimes, and I know it may sound silly, they want to know, why do you like for me to open up the car door? Not just telling them, you need to open up the car door. The brother, once he understands why.
That is good.
That's some good knowledge, guys.
That's why we have to teach a young man. See, we say, oh, we got to teach them to, you know, grab the groceries for the elderly. And we tell them what to do, but we don't tell them the why. You know, one, it makes you, I tell the young men who I work with, I tell them, look, it makes you look like you're really weak. When a young lady walks by and they're carrying all these bags of groceries and you don't extend your hand to help, it makes it look like you're really weak. And so the young men, they're like, oh, man, I'm not weak. So then all of a sudden, the next person they see carrying some bags, you see they running, grab the bags. See, I'm strong. I'm strong, Pastor Allen. I'm strong. But understanding why, it was able to provoke them to move in a way that they would not have moved ordinarily.
Wow, that's really so good.
So definitely, so we want to, is it, so with that, are you saying that maybe the way the messages are presented, maybe that's...
That has a lot to do with it. Okay. The messages the whole, for instance, David and Goliath story, mm-hmm. And this is just fresh on my mind because I preached that text last week.
Okay.
But I took a different angle because we have, in my church, we have over 5 generations represented.
Okay.
So you have to be intentional and try to reach everyone.
Mm-hmm.
So the title of my message was really a question. It was, what are you wearing?
Mm.
And so David, a young lad who he grew up, had his father, mm-hmm. had brothers. But now there's this giant that is taunting and, mm-hmm. and haunting mm-hmm. the Israelites.
Mm-hmm.
The old folk are afraid of this giant.
Mm-hmm.
The adults. Right. Saul didn't even want to fight
right.
Goliath.
Right.
But here it is. David runs up to the battle and says, I'll fight. He says, because I've been trained.
Mm-hmm.
I've had experiences with other grown folk issues, a lion and a bear. So mm-hmm. here it is now. I know I can take out Goliath
mm-hmm.
because the God who helped me with these other grown folk issues can help me with Goliath.
Mm-hmm.
So Saul says, all right, I want to put my armor on you. Most preachers will stop right there and will begin to exegete the text and say, well, maybe David didn't want to wear the armor because David tells Saul, I can't wear that because mm-hmm. it hasn't been tested.
Mm-hmm.
Some people would say, well, he was a young boy, so he couldn't wear the armor. Mm-hmm. It didn't fit. And mm-hmm. I've seen some wonderful illustrations where the brother put on a big suit coat on the little fella, and he's like, see, this is not meant for him.
Mm-hmm.
God wants to give you something custom tailored for you.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
See that hoop right there, guys?
And it sounds good. But this is the dilemma. David didn't say, I can't wear this because it doesn't fit. David simply says, I can't wear it because it hasn't been tested.
Mm.
The same Hebrew word that Job Amen. Uses when he says, though I am tried or tested in the fire,
mm-hmm.
I shall come out as pure gold.
Mm-hmm.
So what does Amen. That tell me? A faith that hasn't been tested is a faith that can't be trusted.
Wow.
So now the men are looking at it, okay, but why ask the question, what am I wearing?
Mm-hmm.
What was Saul really trying to put on David? Saul was laced with insecurities.
Mm-hmm.
Saul was a jealous king.
Mm-hmm.
He was That's an true. Evil king.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Some mm-hmm. would even argue that he was a fraudulent king mm-hmm. because he was the king that the people wanted. So God allowed them to have this king. We have to be careful. Men have to be careful to not allow other men and sometimes women mm-hmm. to put their insecurities on them, to put mm-hmm. their jealousies on them, mm-hmm. to make them wear what they were wearing.
That's real bad.
So we have to make sure that we understand that we have an identity, we have a particular character that we're supposed to have, and we should have a certain vision mm-hmm. or purpose about our lives. If you can wear those things, and the 3 points I said that you should always wear: the garment of faith, the garment of confidence, and the garment of praise.
That's good.
Those are the garments that men have to wear. So having them look at Scripture in another way and then see themselves in the Scripture. How many times have you put on garments, maybe not physically,
mm-hmm.
but spiritually, mm-hmm. socially, emotionally, mm-hmm. we put on certain garments that we have no business wearing.
Wow.
Man.
Wow. That makes you That's think,
good.
Right?
That's good.
I hope that yeah. makes sense.
That's
yeah,
good.
And it makes you think.
You guys that are on here, gentlemen, ladies, grab your husbands, grab your sons, your nephews. Share this if they're not around in the house. Share it. Tag somebody. Because yes. Pastor Al.
Is it Pastor? I'm senior. They call me Pastor Al.
But I'm her Pastor Al. Okay.
Senior,
but he is dropping some wisdom that I will really believe would bless you. So
Amen.
Make sure that you're sharing the video. Also, if you have any questions, you may call in. He's sitting on a lot yeah. of wisdom.
I may not have an answer, but you can call in and ask your question.
So with what has happened, what would you say how this what's going on in church, how has this trickled into like the communities and maybe had any type of impact on like the families and things like that?
Well, the family structure as we once knew it, it does not look the same.
Mm-hmm.
That goes back to what I was saying earlier, the village.
Mm-hmm.
We need to start healing the village. We have to make sure that, one, in Chicago alone, 1 out of every 2 African-American men are unemployed.
Wow.
1 out of 2. So that's, every.
That's
so if you have a man that's unemployed,
yeah.
Do you know how less of a man that makes him feel mm-hmm. in society? Mm-hmm. Men have so much stacked up against them. And I tell men this all the time. No one's going to give you anything.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So you have to go out and get it. But what do you tell that man to go out and get if there's no opportunities in the that's congruent mm-hmm. to where he lives?
Right, right.
You know, I do a lot of work in the Austin community. Austin is so far from the center of commerce, and there's nothing mm-hmm. out there. There's a food desert out there. Mm-hmm. So you tell the brother on the street, you need to get up off the street and get a job. Where?
Where?
And it took a Caucasian gentleman mm-hmm. helped me look at this differently. He said, Alan, look at the stock market. Look at the trading floor. He said, who do you see on the trading floor?
Mm-hmm.
He said, you don't see African-American mm-hmm. males on the trading floor.
Mm-hmm.
He said, you see white men. Mm-hmm. He said, those white men are equivalent to the same black men that you see on the street corners. The only difference is that someone gave them an opportunity.
Mm-hmm. Right.
He said, because the same skill set, they got to think quick on their feet.
They do, right.
He said, it's the same skill set. He said, so when we approach the brother on the street corner, telling them that we're going to help them, you know, get a job and, you know, you'll invest your money and then 10 years later you'll have this. And they're like, 10 years? And I can make X amount of money mm-hmm. in 10 minutes?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, it's wrong what they're doing,
right.
But yet that skill set to think about a life-altering situation, the critical thinking skills mm-hmm. that it takes, mm-hmm. the mm-hmm. math skills,
wow.
to make
right.
sure that they're right. not shorted when they're in that exchange or the mm-hmm. product. You know, so those things we have to look at and take a practical approach. And
mm-hmm.
We need more investors in the community that will invest jobs. I'm so glad that the Obama Presidential Center is coming mm-hmm. to Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to create so many opportunities.
Amen.
But we need to see more of that.
Right.
It's not enough. So I think that's the approach that many have taken. Dr. Brazier, he has a manufacturing plant the West Pullman area.
Mm-hmm.
And the whole idea was to create jobs for African-Americans and those in the community, and where the revenue goes back into the community.
Mm-hmm.
So they learn robotics. They're partnered with the Chicago State University.
Mm-hmm.
But I would love to see more of that happening in our communities. And we'll begin to see, I think, the dynamics shift and change, where these men who are unemployed, they begin to have jobs, and now they're back on their feet, and now they can be the man that they've envisioned or have always aspired
right.
to be.
Right. Amen. That's real good.
You mentioned that you grew up with your mom and your grandfather.
Yes.
And I know from working with males, some of the young men that I work with on a daily basis, they don't even have a grandfather in the house. It's
right.
his mom
That's
and maybe
right.
aunt,
right.
grandmother. You know, what would you say to a young man who did not grow up with a father and struggles with identity, doesn't have the type of role models that he needs? You know, mm-hmm. what would you say? Because sometimes it's so hard for a teacher. In fact, I was talking to a group of boys on Friday.
Yes.
Who the administration has decided all of them have challenges with their behavior.
Mm-hmm.
It's about 14 of them. They put them in one room with a male teacher.
Yes.
And I'm struggling because I'm like, and I just told them because they're so disrespectful. They were quiet when I got done with my speech because I was just like, I went into mama mode, you know, but I don't know what else to do.
Yes.
You know, and so I only had them for an hour, you know, but, and you just pray. And I told them, my one thing I told them during our conversation, I said, I pray that you at some point listen to me and you remember this conversation. That we had within these four walls,
mm-hmm.
and it won't be the four walls of a prison cell.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
right.
and I did tell them, I said, because the statistics would say that's where you're going to end up.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Some of you. But when you have a teacher who loves you, you know, who's trying to prevent that,
yes.
you know, and so they listened, you know, but it's just, you just don't know if they get it. You know, what mm-hmm. would you say? It's so hard.
Well, you don't know, and that's true. You don't know if they're getting it or not.
Mm-hmm.
One, remember, men, young boys, saying it's the mind. So the way they're processing it,
mm-hmm.
you can't tell. It's
yeah.
hard to discern
yeah.
and interpret how
yeah.
someone is processing information. until they begin to act out the information that they've been given. Mm-hmm. Then you can say, okay, they may have learned that from that lesson I shared. I think that sometimes the answer to the problem, and Jim Collins says this in his book From Good to Great, mm-hmm. he says that usually the answer to a problem is readily prevalent if we're honest about the problem. Mm. He said the solution is there, mm-hmm. but it takes being honest about the problem. Mm-hmm. I think, Sister Dimeka, you know the answer. I remember what you did for Career Day at Rootyard.
Right.
You went out and strategically got black males mm-hmm. to come in on Career Day.
Right.
We can't just talk to the men and expect them to just end up becoming the men that we desire them to be.
Yeah.
We got to go and find the mentors out there.
Yeah.
Find the men and bring them to them
because
it's all about exposure.
Mm-hmm.
You can't expect someone to be something that they've never been exposed to. So it all starts with exposure. So you did what a lot of people don't do. Expose these young males to adult males who are successful
and look like us, look like
that
them,
look like them,
and are from some of the same neighborhoods, had some of the same challenges, same experiences. But it's rough, I'm telling you.
It is rough.
But I do think definitely those experiences, that's what they remember. Like I see it all the time. My students don't remember me teaching about metaphors. They don't remember that. They remember the different things that we've done.
Yes.
The people that they've met, the things I've taken them to see. They remember those things.
So they do.
It's those experiences. So that's good.
Yeah, yeah. And now now it's fair to expect them to be better because you've exposed them to something.
Right, you know mm-hmm. better.
You know, yeah. I remember taking a group of kids bowling one day, and they were just, I mean, they took over the whole alley. They running. I'm trying to tell them to sit down. Said, y'all sit down. Y'all act like y'all ain't never been nowhere. And then one of the kids said, we ain't.
Wow.
Right.
They had.
Right. Yeah. Right.
So it's all about exposure.
It is. Mm-hmm.
And they were excited just to get somewhere.
Absolutely.
Things that we've taken for granted in our childhood.
Right. Yes. You know, yes.
So bowling was like, you know, that
it was a luxury.
Right.
Yeah
for them.
Yeah.
Wow. So we want to, as we're getting ready to close out shortly, just what would be your best advice to give to a man to empower him?
So I guess the best advice that I could give to any brother, any man, is that God called you to be the head, not just the head of a woman, but to be the head in life.
Amen.
You weren't meant to be the tail.
Amen.
You weren't meant to be a borrower. You were meant to be a lender. But it starts with your identity. You have to speak to yourself and understand that your identity is tied up to your purpose in life.
Amen.
When you don't know who you are, you will spend a lifetime doing what you're not, doing who you are not.
Mm-hmm.
But once you know who you are, everything that you begin to do in life, you don't hook up with the people that doesn't match your identity,
mm-hmm.
the people that taint your brand.
That's good.
You
That's good.
you don't make the decisions. The word decision in itself, the root of that word, cis,
mm-hmm.
is where we get the Latin word, which means to cut, to do away with.
Mm-hmm.
Every decision you make as a man, know that something or someone is being cut.
Wow.
Whether you're saying yes to something or if you're saying no to something, something is being cut. What I would challenge That's brothers good. To do is, what do you want to see cut from your life? What negative things you want to see cut?
Mm-hmm.
Then make the right decision so that those things can be cut away.
That's good.
The Hebrew writer, we believe to be Paul, says it like this, to lay aside every weight.
Wait.
There's some things that just keeps us from running the race, that keeps us from moving ahead, that we have the power to get rid of.
Wow.
Everything, yes, there's a lot in society that's stacked up against you, but God has given you the power to take some things into your own hand and do away with those weights.
Mm-hmm.
Cut some stuff off, cut some people off, no matter who it hurts.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the day, for every yes, it requires a no.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Make the right decisions.
That's good. And that's something I know my sister does too. We tell students all the time, make the right decision.
Make the right decision.
Make the right decisions, because it has a it impacts you so greatly. And so we're so grateful that you took the time out of your schedule to be here.
I'm so glad to be with you all.
And we want you to talk about your tailoring company.
Yes.
What you do. Tell us how people can reach you. Tell us where you serve at church. You know, just if they want to come by and see you and, you know.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Tell us about all that.
So I do have a website, alconley.com. You can visit the website. Al Conley Chicago Inc. is the tailoring company. If you need to reach me, you can go right to the website, shoot me a message. I serve at the Metropolitan Apostolic Community Church as the senior assistant pastor. The board voted about 6 months ago to make me the senior assistant pastor.
Yay!
Hallelujah. Glory be to God.
When we met you, that wasn't the case.
That was not the case.
But you were, I think you were transitioning from.
I had just transitioned there. But my pastor, he has an awesome legacy. He turns 80 years old in July.
Wow.
And that's why I was late getting here. He's 80 years old. Yeah. So, you know, they take their time and they feel like they've earned the right to take their time.
And he has.
But it was invaluable, the time that I spent with him today. And we were just talking about the succession and how things should look. And so I'm ecstatic.
He said, best tailor hands down. Caleb.
Caleb is my man. I can't wait to see him. Gifted young man, great taste, exquisite taste. Definitely, he's a dapper dude. And so, if you all want to see his pieces, look at his garment. You can go on Instagram, Al Conley Chicago Inc.
Good,
and see
yes.
Caleb's garment is hanging out there in digital land. It got a lot of likes and people love the garment. So,
yeah. And you're on Facebook as well.
Facebook, Alan B. Conley, Twitter, Al Conley.
Good. So make sure you follow him. Go ahead.
This is Life Live. So I'm actually on another show. Yeah, they came to our church and they wanted me to talk about family. Because there was a sister who she found her long lost sister. And I don't know if you are familiar with the show. I think it comes on TLC.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And
wow.
Devon Franklin hosted. But she found her sister. And so her sister came into Chicago and they brought her to the church. And so I was on that show.
Wow, so you're just becoming a celebrity.
No, I'm not. But it does feel good. When I go in, I go in Brown Sugar Bakery and they're whispering behind the counter, aren't you the pastor that was on Black Girl Chicago? Like, wow, I feel like a celebrity in this place.
They're like, ask
can I get
autograph?
A free piece of cake?
All right, and make it karma. Oh, for the Black Chicago Inc.
Yes.
Right,
Black Inc.
Chicago.
Right.
So we encourage you guys to please share the video. It has been such an awesome blessing to have Pastor Conley here with us. I'm humbled and honored that he will also be speaking at our graduation. I don't know if I told you they changed the date, because CPS changed the date to the 14th now.
Really?
Yeah, so we couldn't have any graduations before the 14th. So
okay.
I just found that out. But anyway,
right.
He has agreed. I guess he's still available.
Our graduation year.
He's
spoken our graduation years ago, so he does graduations.
That's right.
Yeah,
you spoke at his.
I forgot. I remember once we met again. And he was like, "Oh, you work." My time where I worked, he has spoken at our graduation, so he does that too, guys. So he is just all around,
all over the place, all on TV, and it's on TV in the pulpulpit.
No, y'all brought me on here to let me know I was.
No, I wasn't graduating.
He's been doing this for 69 years.
I was like, "You've been tailoring for 20 years." Two decades. But it has been a pleasure and an honor. And we appreciate your acts of service to us on today. And we pray that the men were encouraged. So, ladies, please share the video. Tag a brother. Tag your son. Tag your dad. So that they may be encouraged. And tag your friends, too. Yeah, your female friends. He has some nuggets of wisdom that he dropped for us as well. So, we appreciate you so much for coming in. We want to close out with this scripture. 1 Corinthians 15 and 58. And it reads, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord. Because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain.
Which goes definitely what you said, the service, right?
Yes.
We want to be served. servants. Praise God.
And so, that's what we do. We humbly serve the Lord with gladness.
Y'all see how they just brought the anointing back in here? They just
of course. And we are
praise
just
God.
We praise God for you, and we speak that many, many people be calling you for tailoring, that you'll continue to be to be on even more shows, everything whatever God has for you.
And just as that the church would continue to grow.
Amen.
Thank
as
you.
The Lord
Thank
has
you.
Transitioned you to what was prophesied over your life years ago. And may God continue to use you to be a blessing to young people.
Praise
we need
God.
More men of God like you. So we appreciate you taking your time
Thank
to be here
so
with
much.
Us today. It's been a blessing. We're going to close out with Jason Nelson, I Am. Thank you to
Thank
everyone.
Thank you.
Tuned in
probably
today.
Going to go start watching the game, right? Is it come on already?
That's right.
You said go Cavs.
Yeah, go Cavs.
But right. We're so thankful. And we will see you guys same place, same time next Sunday.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
The maker of the universe. I am the one who spoke into nothing, and all creation heard. I am he who has all power in my hands. And if you believe on my word, a tower where you can run and hide. I am he who has all power in my hands. And if you believe on my word, you can stand. I am a healer, mender. And where
who I am.